Sure looks like a great day to be in the water, don't you think? Then again, when you're into boating, is there ever not a great day to be on the water? For the next few minutes, I want to talk about something that's important if you want beautiful waterways like this one to go boating on forever. You've heard about it. You've read about it. And today, you're going to see how easy it is to do something about it. Aquatic nuisance species. Invasive plants and animals introduced into marine and fresh waters where they're not native and they don't belong. Come on, let's head down to the boat access and see what we can find.
Quite the contrary, my friend. Coming home with an empty stringer of fish does not constitute a lousy day of fishing. No siree, Bob. Yeah, it's a little known fact that catching too many fish can have an adverse reaction in males of European descent. Yeah, which, you know, could lead to carpal tunnel syndrome.
Excuse me, sir?
Oh, hey, how you doing? Yeah, just teaching my friend here a little bit about angling, but looks like he jinxed me. It's funny, you know, how most people call it fishing, but it's really angling. That cracks me up. People.
Sir, I'd like to talk to you about aquatic nuisance species. You know, zebra mussels, Eurasian water milfoil, hydrilla, and other invaders.
Believe it or not, I know all about that.
You do?
Oh, sure. By the way, you know how the Eurasian water milfoil got its name?
No, I guess I don't.
This noxious weed became quite a nuisance in 17th century Europe because it invaded mill ponds. It was here that mammoth clumps of the weed would break off and plug up the mills, thus foiling their operations. Hence the name, milfoil. Now, as you were saying.
Yes. Aquatic nuisance or exotic species. Anytime they're introduced into new places, they can grow quickly, crowd out native species, and harm fishing and recreation. And once they start, they're almost impossible to get rid of. In fact, if you're not careful, they could even end up here.
What, in this lake?
In this lake. And do you know how they could end up in this lake?
Well,
it usually starts with boaters who don't know all the facts about how to stop them from spreading.
I hear you there, which is why I'm one of the more knowledgeable boaters you'll find this side of the Nile, which I think happens to be 4,180 miles long.
So tell me, what sort of things do you look for as you trailer your boat before leaving the access?
Yeah, I've got a keen eye for this sort of thing. It's because I eat a lot of carrots, you know. So if I see any of that stuff on my boat, shake them off, get rid of them. You betcha.
Let's have a look, shall we? Before we check your boat, any idea of what these exotics look like? There's hundreds of different ones, you know.
Well, I'll have you know you're talking to a closet biology fanatic.
Why did I know that?
Well, first you got your zebra mussels. See, they're about the size of my fingernail and are native to the freshwater regions of the Caspian Sea in Asia. Well, here in North America, you know, they were first discovered in Lake St. Clair near Detroit. Probably came over on commercial vessels from overseas. These little guys clog water systems of power plants and water treatment facilities, cause problems for fish and wildlife, and stink up those beaches, costing everybody a lot of money. Then you got your Eurasian water milfoil, a plant with 12 to 21 pairs of leaflets that form dense mats that crowd out native water plants and clog waterways. And they spread from lake to lake by clinging to boats, trailers, and the like. And last, but certainly not least, you got your hydrilla, which looks like your basic aquarium plant with spear-shaped leaves that have saw-toothed edges. You see, hydrilla removes oxygen from the water and causes fish to die, not to mention making shallow waters impassable. Any questions?
Yes. Now, can we take a look at your boat?
Sure. Yeah, looks like we're good to go. Have yourself a good day.
Sir?
Yeah?
Aren't you forgetting something?
Knowing
what exotic species look like is just the start. Here's what you need to do. Thoroughly inspect your boat, trailer, and equipment, and remove all plants and animals before leaving any water body. Don't forget those little places like bow line, license plates, wiring, lights, rollers or bunks, floors, axles, motor and trolling motor, transducer, fish nets, and anchors. Then drain all water from your boat, especially live wells and bait buckets.
Yeah, Lord knows I'm going to need plenty of room in this live well for those lunkers.
Next, dispose of unwanted bait on shore. Never release leftover bait, or for that matter, any unwanted aquarium plants, fish, or snails into a water body. And be careful of bait buckets. If you dip them into infested waters, they can contain zebra mussels you can't even see. Most exotics die within a few days, but some can survive more than 2 weeks out of water. If you moor your boat for more than a day, make sure you do some additional things. Either rinse your boat and trailer with hot tap water, at least 104 degrees, or spray them with high-pressure water, checking all nooks and crannies around depth sounders and trim tabs. Then, allow them to dry for at least 5 days.
Ah, that was easy as pie.
It is easy. And it's important as someone who uses our waterways to help take care of our waterways. Now, if you'll excuse me, I have to find somebody with a sailboat.
Hey, why didn't you say so? You're talking to the Admiral here. You know, over 85% of the Earth's surface is covered with water. That's why I like to spend 85% of my free time on the water. Is that a wacky coincidence or what? Hey, I got an idea. I'll go get a sailboat. Meet you at Round Lake tomorrow. This is your basic 14-foot sailboat, so as not to confuse you novices.
Okay, so how is checking a sailboat different than checking, say, a fishing boat?
Ah, very good question. You know, it's a little-known fact that the sailboat has been around ever since the Aztecs invented the bedsheet. In fact, I believe the word Aztec translates in English to bombsetta.
You don't say. But can we get back to business? Oh. The same basic checkpoints apply for a sailboat. Remove all plants and animals from your boat and trailer before leaving any water body. Here, don't forget to check the centerboard where it retracts into the hull, plus the rudder and transom. Drain all water before you leave a water body. And wash and dry your boat and equipment the same way you would a fishing boat. Got that?
Oh, hey, you don't have to tell me twice. You know, the human mind is a veritable sponge, and yours truly happens to have one labeled extra absorbent.
So tell me, Admiral. Mind if I call you Admiral?
Yeah, hey. I'd be honored.
Okay, Admiral. I have one more thing to cover. Mm-hmm. Any chance you might have a personal watercraft?
Does the sun rise in the east? Look, if it goes underwater, I can get one. Now, don't you go away. I'll be back faster than you can say, zebra mussel. Yeah, being on one of these things reminds me of my youth. Ever tell you about the time I was in the Indy 500?
Mm-hmm. We better move on before we draw a crowd.
Yeah. Good idea.
Okay, you were just out running your personal watercraft. Now, what do you do to help stop the spread of aquatic nuisance species?
Well, I check for plant and animal life, and then I yank them off.
Yes, but a personal watercraft is a little different. Underneath, you have a jet drive system that holds water and could easily trap exotic species and transport them to new waters if you're not careful. Here are a few simple steps you need to know. First, don't run your engine through aquatic plants before you leave the water. Push or winch your watercraft onto the trailer without running the engine. Look under your watercraft and pull all plants from the water intake area. Make sure you check the edges of the grate over this area. Now, simply start and run your engine for 5 to 10 seconds to blow out any excess water and vegetation.
Check.
Turn off the engine and pull all plants from the steering nozzle.
Check-a-doodle.
Inspect your trailer and other equipment for plants or plant fragments and remove them before you leave the access. And finally, wash your watercraft and trailer to get rid of anything you missed, or dry them for 5 days.
I think I've got it.
You are a quick study.
Hey, I'm smart. Been told I'm ruggedly handsome. Own a lot of boats and, well, I love to fish. You know, you might say, I'm a man. M-A-N.
Yes. Yes, you are. And on that note...
Remember your aquatic nuisance species. Zebra mussels, Eurasian water milfoil, hydrilla, and others. You know, as a guy who loves being on water, we share a special bond. And we share a responsibility to stop the spread of exotics. It only takes a few minutes to do the simple steps we just covered. Inspect your boat or watercraft and its trailer. Drain all water. Get rid of unwanted live bait on shore, then wash or dry your boat and trailer. If you've moored your boat in infested waters, wash it first, then dry it at least 5 days. Do it for your country. Do it for your fellow man. Do it for your love of the water.
Very moving. Kind of brings a tear to your eye.
Well, you know, some people have a way with words and others not have way.
And there you have it. Remember, control the spread of aquatic nuisance species, and have a great day on the water.
Hey, not so fast. The Admiral here has several more vessels in his fleet. I'll go get them, okay? Oh, hey, don't leave yet. So what do you want, a race boat, a catamaran, a hydrofoil? How about a canoe? I got an inner tube in the garage. How about some water wings? Hey, don't go away.